ओके परफेक्ट। वी नीड टू डू समथिंग अबाउट दिस। ऑल राइट, सो नाउ विल क्विकली मूव ऑन टू साइकोजेनिक साइकोलॉजिकल थियरीज ऑफ somatic symptoms, and essentially they are divided into psychoanalytical
the screen
oh sorry Yeah, please don't hesitate to remind me when I forget. All right. Okay. So psychoanalytic. Then you have the psychophysiological. Then you have the systemic or biopsychosocial. Who gave the term biopsychosocial? So it was an angel who came from the heaven and gave that term. It was George Engel or Engel, but that's the mnemonic that I usually use to make sure you don't forget it. They will also ask you a couple of fathers, right? So they'll ask you the father of modern psychiatry. They'll ask you the some of the people who invented some medications for the first time. So these are some rote memory questions that they would want you to know. Does anyone know who is the father of psychiatry?
Freud.
Sorry, can you repeat that again?
Sigmund Freud.
No, unfortunately, Sigmund Freud is not the father of psychiatry.
Sir, Johann Christian Reil.
Reil gave the term psychiatry. Johann Christian Reil, I think, gave the term psychiatry, but the father of American psychiatry is Dr. Benjamin Rush. So that is usually the term they want us to say, I think, is Dr. Benjamin Rush. But he was a very controversial figure. And yeah. Okay. So we have the systemic or the biopsychosocial, and then you have the sociocultural theories. All right. Now, the common ones that
there is a lot of noise.
Yeah, muted it. So the common ones that I think are essential for a conceptual understanding is that Sigmund Freud gave the psychoanalytical theories. One of them is the concept of dammed up or accumulated psychic energy. So this is similar to the hydraulic model that we studied in aggression, that eventually the frustrations end up gathering, and then you end up having a physiological outlet. And this outlet, because you cannot have in a healthy verbal way, what happens is that the way it comes out is in the form of a symbolic substitution or a somatization. And that's why a lot of people say that if, you know, there is this theory that if you have had the major conflict in your life right now is a relationship issue, then you'll have heartache or chest pains. If you have work-related issues, then you'll have headache. So I think this is something that a lot of PG teachers like asking. Then comes in the psychophysiological ones, and these are essentially associated with the autonomic nervous system hyperactivity. That due to somatic symptoms, the autonomic nervous system becomes hyperactive, and what results is that the somatic symptoms can eventually branch out into immunology. So three new branches of psychiatry or neurological studies are developed because of the psychophysiology of somatic symptoms, and those are psychoimmunology, psychocardiology, and psychoendocrinology. All right. Then comes the systemic or the biopsychosocial models. And the systemic model essentially is, there is a very important model, which is the mind-brain model. Right? And the mind-brain model says that the biological brain and the social mind are interconnected. And major brain pathways, the way these pathways function, is influenced a lot by how our psychosocial aspects of our personality are. And the sociocultural is one of the simplest examples of that, is the Holmes and Rahe scale. So I got this question in my paper B, I think. What is the most stressful event in a person's life? So they created a hierarchy. Holmes and Rahe developed a scale. I think a lot of you might know this. They developed a scale in which they ranked the stressful events in a person's life. And can anyone tell me in that, what was the highest rated event?
Loss of spouse.
Yeah, great answer. Loss of spouse. So I was asked this question in my paper B. Loss of spouse is the highest rated stressor in a person's life as per Holmes and Rahe scale. So that brings us an end to somatic symptoms and its biological theories and its psychogenic theories. Now, should we continue with dissociation right away? How deep do you want to delve into dissociation? Can anyone just tell me?
So for now, whatever is important for the exam, because dissociation otherwise would be too long to discuss.
Exactly. So I don't think you need to know a lot of things. I'll just give you an overview of what dissociation syndromes do they usually ask, and your basic understanding, right? Because it's not really conceptual and you don't have a lot to understand. We'll cover the basic, what do you say, the basics of it. So usually in a person's personality or in a person's identity, you have a normal integration is there, right? And that integration exists between one's memories, one's identity, sensory, and motor components. And this integration is lost in dissociative disorders. So the ability to exercise conscious control, this is the important line that you need to remember, and your concept regarding dissociative disorders will become very clear once you are able to digest this diagram particularly. So the ability to exercise conscious control over your mind is lost. And because of this, so what would you say, what would you call the disorder where because of this your memories are lost?
Dissociative amnesia.
Okay, good. What would you call the disorder where identity is lost?
Dissociative identity disorder.
Right. What about the sensory and motor ones?
Dissociative anesthesia.
Disorder, like
conversion is a part of dissociative disorders in the ICD, but it is a part of the somatic symptoms in the DSM. So that is one more controversy that you will come across. But they did ask me during my paper A that conversion disorder is a part of dissociative or somatic or mood or psychotic. So in the UK, they tend to follow the ICD much more than the DSM. In my country, that is in India, we usually follow DSM. So if they do ask a question like this, go for dissociation, because they tend to follow the ICD, right? All right. So what happens? Let's just quickly brief through the dissociative disorders, because I don't think there is a lot of biology to it. What happens in dissociative amnesia?
You tend to forget emotionally charged events.
Yeah. And in classic cases of dissociative amnesia usually do present with somatization and conversion as well. So classically, it won't be only dissociative amnesia. The patient won't come to you with saying, "Doctor, I forgot everything." They will usually have some somatic complaints and some conversion complaints as well. All right. And non-classical symptoms of dissociative amnesia, like the Bourne movies, will present with self-mutilation and violence. So those are non-classical symptoms of dissociative amnesia. Then there is this specifier that dissociative amnesia has, is that whether it is with dissociative fugue or without dissociative fugue. Everyone knows what fugue is?
Yes, sir.
Right. So it is purposeful, yes, but non-specific traveling associated with loss of memory, which is partial or complete in nature, right? And usually how do you treat dissociative amnesia is, if you do psychoanalysis, you will find that there is some childhood trauma. And at a lot of places, they also do phenobarbital or pentothal interviews to treat dissociative amnesia. What happens in dissociative identity disorder is, again, similar to what we discussed with amnesia. We covered the fugue. And there are two essential, the key word as far as dissociative identity disorder is that there are two or more personality states. Right? And these two or more personality states have different cognition. They have different consciousness. They have different thoughts, feelings, behaviors, and everything. And there is complete amnesia regarding those behaviors in the two or more personality states. And these usually present with memory gaps. Now, genuine patients will be confused, conflicted, and ashamed. Genuine patients will be confused, conflicted, and ashamed. Right? So that is that. What is the depersonalization or derealization syndrome? Depersonalization is the key words that you need to remember as far as depersonalization and derealization is concerned. Are unreality or detachment. So whenever you read these two keywords, because they tend to ask you a lot of case snippets that this person presented with a sense of unreality. Now, usually those words will just go by, you know, you won't notice those words. But when you hear these two words, that is when you hear unreality and when you hear detachment. Detachment, we don't tend to forget a lot. Detachment is a word that sticks out. But unreality sometimes doesn't stick out. So if this detachment or unreality is related to self, own thoughts, own feelings, own perceptions, then what would you call it?
Depersonalization.
Exactly. And if this sense of unreality or detachment is associated with surroundings, then what would you call it?
Derealization.
Okay. And what about the reality testing? In depersonalization and derealization, is the reality testing intact or is it disturbed?
Disturbed.
So this is a common mistake. The reality testing is present. It is intact. This is again a very important MCQ. All right? But so, there is a disintegration. Yeah, please go on.
So regarding reality testing, like some psychotic patients will also can give presentations like derealization kind of picture. So like, is reality testing the thing we use to distinguish? Because in those patients, reality testing...
Then psychosis is the primary pathology, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah.
Then in that case, psychotic is or psychosis is the primary pathology. Then depersonalization and derealization is just a symptom of or a part of those things. But in depersonalization or derealization disorder, the patient will have intact reality testing and the patient will describe to you, I felt as if I was not living in my body. I felt as if I had a out-of-body experience. I felt as if the world around me was not mine.
Okay.
All right. And these are usually associated with a traumatic or stressful event. There is disintegration of ego, but there is intact reality testing. And you usually treat it with SSRIs. There is good role of NMDA antagonists in depersonalization, derealization, but not much to read into it. Right? Okay. Then you have conversion. So can anyone tell me a couple of tests that we do to identify whether the conversion is true or not? Okay, so I'll give you the condition and you tell me what test you will do. So what if a person says that he has anesthesia, or he cannot feel anything, or complete anesthesia or hemi anesthesia. So how will you check this? What is the test to check this? Anyone? Anyone? Okay. So the way you check for anesthesia or hemi-anesthesia is if it is anesthesia, then you map the dermatomes. And if it is hemi-anesthesia, then you see if there is proper, exactly half body. So if the distribution is unequal, then it won't be true hemianesthesia, would it be? Then, do you know what astasia abasia is?
Type of gait.
Yeah, so what does stasia mean and what does... So describe the gait and then you'll know, I think. Stasia essentially means stationary, stasia, stationary or standing. So the, and basia or abasia essentially means unable to walk properly. So astasia means unable to stand properly, and abasia means unable to walk properly. And when you ask the person to dance, sometimes the patient will do that reflexively, and that is a test that you can perform. So we covered anesthesia, hemianesthesia, astasia, abasia. Then what will you do for paresis or paralysis? You can do the Hoover's test. Can anyone tell me what the Hoover's test is?
Go ahead.
Go ahead, please.
When we try to lift one leg, we feel the contraction of the hamstrings of the opposite leg.
Sir, it is a cross extensor reflex.
Sorry?
Sir, cross extensor reflex is seen.
Can you please elaborate that a little bit more? What do you mean by cross extensor reflex?
Sir, when we are checking for paralysis, that sir, if it is not paralyzed, then there is some contraction can be seen.
Okay, so you will see a certain sense of weight in the other leg. Is that what you are trying to say?
Yes.
When you have lifted one leg, you will feel a little bit of pressure on the other leg. Is that what you are trying to say?
Yes, sir.
Okay, exactly. And how will you check if a person is having true sneezes or hysterical sneezes? So usually the conversion or hysteria sneezes are the ones with eyes open, hardly any aerosol, and these are usually gone in the night or gone when the person is alone. Similarly, how will you test for aphonia? Cough. You'll ask the patient to cough, right? Then how will you check for syncope? You will measure the postural blood pressure. And how will you check for blindness? So whenever you are asked tests to check for blindness, remember the element of surprise. Because that is what you need to work on, right? So you can just wiggle your fingers in front of the patient and tell them to repeat. And before they even realize that they are repeating, they would have already started mimicking you. Or suddenly you can throw a flash of light at the person and he or she will obviously have a reflex to close her eyes. Then you can ask the person to touch your fingers. So you can ask the patient to touch both of your index fingers. And this is something that can happen normally in blind people as well because of proprioception. So if the patient purposefully does not do that, there is a good chance that he is having conversion disorder. And similarly, if a person is in a conversion coma, then he will shut his eyes close even if you are trying to open them. All right. So these are common tests which are essential for conversion disorder. Another dissociative disorder that they usually ask a lot in the paper A and also in paper B is the Ganser syndrome. So can anyone tell me what the Ganser syndrome is?
Sir, approximate answers. Patient give approximate answers.
Okay, so approximate answers.
Yes, sir.
What else?
Commonly seen in prisoners.
Okay. What else?
So with the question that you ask, I mean with the answer that they give, we can know that they can comprehend it, right? But they don't give.
They usually have hallucinations as well. So the way they usually ask you in the exam is they tell you which one of the following is not a commonly observed symptom with Ganser syndrome. and they'll put a delusion or they'll put something like that. And these are commonly seen things. So clouding of consciousness, approximate answers, hallucinations and conversion symptoms. These are the commonly observed things with cancer syndrome. I think that pretty much brings us an end towards somatic and dissociative. Now we have two options right now. I have about half an hour more. Do you want to do memory or do you want to do sleep?
Memory.
Okay. So everyone is for memory, right? Okay, all right. So I'll send you a new link because I think we're already done with about 30 minutes in this. I'll send you a new link. Take 5 minutes of break, have some tea or have some coffee, drink some water, and then come back for memory. Okay, thank you.